guy than your white people.
Yep.
So they didn't have the immunity. So there's the same example. She, what happened was when she started off, she was in a cave with about 30 other of her tribe, and they're all dead. She was the last one. She was dying. And it turned out is that they were eating animals that ate the grass and picked up whatever it is. So that's where they got their all the diseases. And since then, she said she is not allergic to anything. So it's just, again, I'm not there. If I get people to ask me, you know, to explain this particular and why does this happen, I have a good answer. I don't know. I'm not there.
Hey, I just want to...
The point, again, is if it gets rid of your problem, does it matter? But I have heard, I've done thousands of these, so I do see... I've actually had a few times where lives were confirmed by somebody from, like, a good example is roughly is one, a person that had a fear of needles, a very common one. Turned out it was to do with World War II, not the cancer. They were being forced to experiment on their fellow people, the doctor. And this woman's fear of needles disappeared. Now, about 5 years later, it was about last year, I was dealing with somebody else in a different country. And they described being a German doctor in World War II. And I went, I know about this. So I didn't say, I don't lead anything. I'll just say, is there any other doctor there doing experiments that didn't like it? They all laughed and said, yes. There's one doctor, we made him by threat of killing his family to work on his fellow inmates or prisoners.
Uh-huh.
And it was just described to a T. Now, these are not two people that knew each other. They were different countries, and it was years apart. So when you get some of those, and I've had a few, it's like, interesting.
It is.
So again, I just go this way. It's a modality that helps get rid of... So you get rid of a pain in your leg. That's been, you know, making you limp, and now you can walk normal. Maybe you'd be able to do more things, or, you know, I can improve your quality of life, or a fear of heights. There's a fella years ago, he came to me, he said, I got a fear of heights. And he said, I hear you help people get rid of them. I said, sure. He says, I don't believe in God's life. I said, I don't care. So I sat down, I said to him, let your step on show you why you have this fear of heights. And he had said that he doesn't know why. He's had it all his life, and he's never been on a mountain, but if you look at a picture of one, he gets the butterflies, the sweats, it happens all the time. And in the, make it sort of short, in his life, in the session, he said, oh, there's a big mountain there, or a plateau. He said, and there's a Native Indian standing on the ledge. And he said, wow, what an imagination I got. And I said, is it a past life or imagination? No, no, it's just imagination. Then he said, all of a sudden, wait, another guy came up behind him and pushed him off. He said, that's not nice. And I said, probably not. Okay. But the funny thing was he was sitting in the chair, but he was slowly turning his head, following the guy falling down, clicked him off the ledge. And then suddenly hit him. He said, wait a minute, I'm talking about it. It's not bothering me. He just suddenly dawned on him. And I said, his imagination, oh yeah. When we finished, now in a session, I can take care of 2 to 5 different things. That's how quick the system is. It's not like you come back once a month or once a week for the next 2 years, which is a load of crap. It's only 1 or 2 sessions, take care of tons of. At the end, I said, how's your fear of heights? Picture a scene that bothers you. And he said, wow, this doesn't bother me. And I said, is it a past life or imagination? He said, I'm not sure. I said, does it matter? He said, no. But I said, has it been bothering you? He said, yes, he could not go skiing with his family, and he could not go to Disneyland with his family. So it was affecting his quality of life. Got an email from a couple of years later, and he said he's been skiing like crazy with his family and loved it. So you can see what I'm saying is he brought it in from a past life or imagination or whatever. But once he saw where it came from, for some reason, your conscious lets it go, disappears. Because it's nothing to do with this life. And I don't know why. Again, I don't know why, but it works. And it's happened all the time.
Well, a question
do you
have
any fears of phobias?
Oh, I got a lot of them. But I got to ask you one question. There is a place up in Seattle, Washington, and they say they can stop your addiction with alcohol or stop you from smoking by going in through, you know, a series of sessions. Can you control somebody from drinking and stop them from smoking?
Yeah, all these events. I'm not saying everything is past life. I would say roughly only 99%. That's pretty high. In fact, out of thousands of clients, I've had about five in my whole life. Their thing started in this life, so you can see where that's going. Now, smoking and alcohol, all those things, addictions, yes, they're past life. That's why they can't stop them. Now, just a simple one, smoking. Do you smoke?
No, not, was it, but you know, I did 40 years ago, but my wife said if I wanted to marry her, I had to quit. I mean, occasionally, you know, like once a month, I might go out and buy a cigar and smoke it, you know, away from the house. But no, I quit smoking because she laid the law down.
How long ago?
40 years ago.
40?
40.
Yeah, I quit 44 years ago.
Yay. I got fat, but I don't miss it.
No. Well, the way it works is this way. You see, back in the old days, I got three brothers. There's four of us, no girls, no sisters, and mom and dad, six of us. We all smoked. Why? Everybody smoked. Human nature is you want to be part of the crowd. In fact, we used to look funny at people that didn't smoke, and you don't want to have that happen to you. So I smoked, started at 18. Now, what happened is that majority, the stats now, roughly, in North America, the percentage of people that still smoke is only about 19%. Now, they all stand around the places I am for some reason. But anyhow, it seems that way. Now, 19%, obviously, Gary, is not the majority, is it?
No, not at all.
So why are they still smoking? It's because, and I help people with this, it's because it's a past life thing, not a social thing. And quite often, a common one is actually the Native Indians. To be an elder, you had to sit around and you pass the peace pipe around, and it was a privilege. It was to do this. One guy said he hated this, but he had, in fact, in the present life, he said he always felt when he had a cigarette that he earned the right to smoke, and that's why he couldn't quit. Once he saw where it came from, he quit immediately. Well, not during the session, because I don't let you smoke while you're in the session, but he never took a cigarette after that. But I also have a little tricky thing, is that I also help you find where you had your first cigarette in your present life and take that first breath, and almost everybody coughs and chokes right in the session.
Oh, wow.
And I give them the suggestion that any time if you decide to try one more cigarette after the session, every puff will taste like your first one. With a little tricky thing I do add. And your subconscious, because it knows you want to quit, well, make it bring that memory back up. And if you're going to keep choking on their cigarette, you're not going to keep smoking. But again, these are all past life. A lot of things are just like, you know, people see themselves in bars, and or if you're really fancy, you used to have cigarette holders in there for the women.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so nice little cases.
So that's the reason why they couldn't let go. It's the same thing in acre pain. If you can't see where it came from, it doesn't go away.
I don't know.
Alcoholism, stuff like that, it's all a past life that you've done this and have it finished with it.
Yeah,
the
but I mean,
what
do you do? Finish when it kills you, and then you have to go for another life? They try to...
No, the interesting thing about this, let's say you've had a couple hundred past lives, so it's not uncommon. What it is, I say to you, when you're deeply relaxed, that your subconscious take you back to the past life or cause that started it, not how many you had that. Because if you got a problem in this life, obviously it's carried over into this one, so it carries over in other lives. Your subconscious, which is extremely accurate, will take you to the correct one that started it. And then when you see it, and I say go to the correct scene, and when you see it, then I walk you through it. Because I don't see. That's one thing. I'm not a reader. People say, well, tell me what I was in a past life. And I go, I have no idea. I can't see. I'm not a reader. You have to see it. Because if you don't see it, it's hard to let it go. Me telling you you're a gypsy in a past life, Gary, does that make you dance better? Okay. Who knows?
But it could.
You
in my case.
You might have been one. And I'll say, go to the past life and say you're a gypsy. And then you see it. And then you let it go. Yeah. Or you can actually go the other direction and help people with talents. You can people that have that, you know, like they have they're born with a talent, or you know, it's a gift. They've done it in a previous life. That's why you can have siblings that have all different tastes. Nothing to do with your parents; it's all previous past lives. But the way I like to explain it is this way, Gary. It's the, we like to see to believe. So, and I call my system the unknown noise. So here's my example for the listening. Close your eyes. Pretend you're living alone in a, and it's a dark, spooky, windy night, and the wind's howling, okay? And in the middle of the night, there's a crash, and you jump up and go, what the is that being played there? And you hear it again, and you realize it's just the wind blowing a branch against the window. Unless it's going to break, I'd go back to sleep.
Uh-huh.
Later that night, there's another crash, a different one, and you jump up and go, what the is that? And you hear it again, you go, wait a minute, I've never heard that noise before. This is scary, spooky. Maybe somebody coming to kill me, boogie me, or whatever. Now, unless you check it out, most people would do like what we did in, as kids. We'd pull up our bulletproof covers and try and get some sleep. Doesn't work. You're still bothered. Next morning, you're going out the door, you've got to go to work, wind's still howling, and you didn't sleep well. Then you hear that noise, and it's off to your left. You turn over quickly to the left, and see it's just a garbage can blowing in the wind. That neighbor's got, used to have bags, and it's got a garbage can. And you're going to make a profound statement, Gary. It's called, it's a garbage can, plus some adjectives about the stupid neighbor. Next night, you're in bed again, another dark, spooky, windy night. Wind blows the garbage can over. 50-50 chance you don't even bother waking up. But if you do, you're going to make your profound statement again, which is,
well, your I'm not going to say it over the air, but I know what I'd say, but yeah.
And you'll be saying, it's that garbage can again, that stupid neighbor.
Yeah.
Now, there is a point that. Here that I'm explaining. Yeah, there's a point here, Gary. The noise is the same both nights, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Why does it bother you on the second night?
Probably because I realized from the first night what it was.
Yes.
Yeah, so
simple
then,
answer. Yeah, simple answer. Yeah. Ever keep it simple. You know what it is. You know what it is. And you know it's just a garbage can. Now, if I had told you, Gary, that noise you heard, I'm sure it was a garbage can, and you hadn't looked yet, that's somebody telling you what you did or what happened in the past life. I don't know about you, but I don't know if I'd believe the person. I hear that noise, I go, I don't believe them. I'm going to look out the window very carefully. It is the garbage can. It's gone. Now, you had to see it.
Yeah.
I didn't, telling you means nothing. You had to see it. That's how the system works. I had a lady that came to see me last year. She had a fear of deep water, which is a number three fear in the world, most common. Uh-huh. And she said she went to a reader. Now, these readers are accurate. You know, they do know that you did this, this, and this, but it just means it doesn't help you. It's just amusement. He said, yes. She said, he said, yes, you drowned in four past lives. So I said, why are you coming to see me? She says, I still have that fear. So in a session, I said, I'm still going to take you to the past life that started it. It was one of the four. And she no longer has that fear. Because the whole thing is, you see where it came from. Now, one thing I have learned, I should interject here, is apparently we come into the human form to learn lessons. You might have heard that or not. And what lesson it is, we don't know. We sort of decided, apparently, before we came in, but we don't remember, or else you wouldn't learn it if you knew, you know, if you had the script in front of you. And sometimes we don't finish that lesson for two reasons. One, we get killed too soon, or one, we just go the wrong direction. Apparently, when you die and the lessons are done, you have to do it again. And we get tons of lessons. And that's what happened, though, is that the lesson that you didn't finish, if you had, you know, been hung, you also have problems with your neck in this life, or you got stabbed in a certain part, you'll have a pain there that we bring in with it because the subconscious duplicates the acre pain or fear that happened in that life. I don't know why. It's not. Sometimes you have to be careful how you talk to yourself. But it's like once you see it, it's like it lets go. Again? Why? I don't know. Works well.
Well, hey, I got a question. I remember reading about a case of a young kid, like 3-5 years old, remembering that he was a fighter pilot in England during World War II.
Yeah.
Was, I'm sure.
Japan. Yeah.
And then when he got a little bit older, he kind of outgrew it. But I mean, the stuff he was saying when they, you know, were questioning him,
accurate.
It was accurate as could be. Now, have you found cases that accurate ever?
Well, I don't work with kids that young.
Well, no, I'm not talking with kids, but that's a person that, you know,